All right, Crystal, what's on your radar?
This is a robbery in progress. That is how David Dayan, executive editor of the American Prospect, described the corporate bailout provisions negotiated by Republican and Democratic leadership. In his article, Unsanitized Bailouts, a Tradition Unlike Any Other, David digs into the details of the $2 trillion stimulus and bailout bill and comes to a stunning realization. While the public is being told that big business will benefit from a $500 billion slush fund, bad enough, the truth is that the dollar figures for industry are much, much larger. In fact, that money is really going to capitalize $4.25 trillion in lending, a number that, of course, absolutely dwarfs the comparatively trifling $300 billion that small businesses will receive. Remember when they told us we couldn't afford Medicare for All? AOC gets it. She's been probably more critical of this bill than any other member, tweeting, "Just a reminder that there is absolutely no good reason why Senate Republicans are tying a historic corporate giveaway to getting relief money in the hands of families. They could just authorize sending checks to families today, right now, and deal with the rest. But they refuse. So big business is awash in cash that, remember, many of them probably don't even need, while small businesses are left vulnerable to be scooped up by the big boys in another round of massive consolidation that will leave everyone, from the local entrepreneur to the worker, far worse off. And about those workers, even the pathetically inadequate $1,200 that they're supposed to get will not be showing up anytime soon. Only those who have direct deposits set up with the IRS will get that cash infusion in a remotely timely fashion. Everyone else is going to have to wait 4 months. Compare that to the lavish generosity and certainty granted corporate America versus the precariousness and instability offered average Americans. Remember, millions of them are being laid off from their jobs right now, meaning a loss of their employer-provided health care if they had it. Nothing in this bill changes any of that. Even treatment for coronavirus is not covered in this bill. And as we worry about kids from poor households missing the school lunch that they and their families depend on, this bill doesn't even increase SNAP benefits. It's pathetic. Meanwhile, the labor unions that still exist will sustain a massive blow as their members are laid off and their pension funds, already under tremendous pressure, slip into deeper insolvency. But do you think supposedly pro-labor Democrats managed to get one single dollar into this bill in order to protect the only organizations that are dedicated to worker solidarity and power? Of course they didn't. They'll let them further wither on the vine, just like they always do. So much of this, too, is a replay of 2008. Once again, Democrats put up token hashtag resistance to the corporate bailouts, managing to extract nothing more than some oversight cosplay. Great. We'll have an inspector general who oversees the looting of the public purse. Terrific. The irony of the very people who impeached Donald Trump for supposedly being a unique threat to the nation now handing his administration $4 trillion in play money for corporate giveaways should be lost on no one. Not one of the bailout provisions that we've been pushing for here is fully included in this bill. Elizabeth Warren has been oddly silent on that part. CEOs, they can still take home millions. And after a short period, these companies can even resume stock buybacks. The government, we get no equity position. Workers get no board positions. Wages are not lifted. And outside of the airline industry, they're under no obligation to even keep their workers. Contrast that, by the way, with small businesses, which must keep their workers as a condition of loan forgiveness. The decisions made now have massive implications. The stakes are so high, and that's why I'm so angry. We had a chance to actually rebalance the scales just a little bit in favor of small business, small towns, and individual workers. Instead, just like after 2008, the big guys will get even bigger and richer, and the little guys will go bankrupt or get bought up in a fire sale. Monopolistic power concentrations will continue to destroy small enterprise, gut our small towns and cities, and strip workers of any semblance of power since they've got no choice but to give their labor for poverty wages to one of our massive, omnipresent corporate overlords. The bottom line is this. $1,200 and unemployment insurance is not nearly enough to trade for a $4 trillion investment in massive corporate control over our country for years to come. Democrats, Republicans, anyone, I implore you, kill this bill. Forget about the corporate bailouts. Pass $2,000 per month, immediate cash assistance with no means testing so it can go out quickly, immediately. Go ahead and beef up unemployment insurance plus small business assistance right now. And if you must do corporate bailouts, they can come later or, you know, not at all. Don't do it because you want to do right by the American people. We all know what masters you serve. But do it because you recognize the moment you're in and how it does, in fact, pose a unique threat to your livelihood and your power. Think about it. Is there any event that led more directly to Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump than the 2008 financial crisis and the disastrous way in which it was handled? If you thought the populist fires burned bright then, you ain't seen nothing yet. If you let this all go down again, with the rich getting richer and everyone else getting just the carefully measured scraps that you believe will be the lowest amount possible to keep the pitchforks at bay, where do you think that's going to lead us? Mark my words, the decisions you make now will reverberate for years to come. Kill this bill. And Sagar, to me, maybe the most significant decision that was made here was to allow Republicans and corporate Democrats to pair the corporate bailout with worker protections and hold them hostage, which is the point that AOC is making there.
That's exactly what happened. And what we talked about for the last 2 weeks, we said, make sure that you separate it. Fight as hard as you can. Get the payments and the small business loans out. Imagine if that had passed 2 weeks ago. They would have been getting a check in 1 week, April 6th.
And, Very different from April 14th, by the way, is really important because the moment that you add in that income restriction, it adds in a layer of bureaucracy. That's why you have to go through the IRS and have people that have to wait 4 months. That's all because if you means test, you just send checks out to everybody. You can make them available.
And you can tax them back later.
And tax them back later. That's the thing to do if you actually care about getting money in people's hands now, which is what needs to happen. They don't care.
And you know, that was the same. I thought that from the beginning of this, I said, this is the one shot that we ever will ever have. That we ever could to have the leverage over big business that government could have in order to get them to change some of their business practices. And what did they extract for us? They got us a year of no stock buybacks and a year of no increase in executive compensation. Nothing on supply chain, nothing on worker protection, nothing on any of the systemic trade problems which led to this crisis in the first place. In fact, I actually have been fighting, you know, there was a story that just broke this morning that of GOP free market groups and the big pharma industry are lobbying against a proposed executive order by the Trump administration called Buy American, which would move or try and encourage supply chains here to the United States. In the middle
even
of a
now,
pandemic,
even now,
in the middle of a pandemic, when we can't get basic drugs and China controls 90% of our pharmaceuticals, and Chinese government officials have openly floated not sending him to us as a way of geopolitical punishment and killing Americans, they don't care.
Yeah.
They still want cheaper drugs so that they can contain higher profits and higher stock prices. That's the economy that we live in right now. And that's why I'm just aghast. They got it through. It's going to pass. AOC, she can, you know, put up a hold all she wants.
I want to give her a lot of credit, though, because, I mean, I want to give Bernie a lot of credit, even though he voted for the bill, and he explained in a live stream, I think, very effectively last night, the sort of trade-offs that are required here. Because, you're going to be a villain. You're essentially you're the person preventing payments to go. And you're standing alone, and he had no one backing him up, right? So at least he kept the bill from being made even worse. Mm-hmm. And AOC is out there alone basically saying, no, I may not go for this unanimous consent. That's what they want, is so that nobody has to come back to D.C., right? Because this can just pass without anyone having to actually record a yes or no vote. And she makes the point, look, yes, it's a health risk. I understand why people don't want to travel back to D.C., but we are asking millions of workers every day to work for low wages in grocery stores and other frontline jobs to put themselves at risk to make sure that this country is still running. This is a very small ask for members of Congress to come back to D.C. and at least record your vote for history of where you stood on this thing. I applaud her for going
I applaud her for that. You know, there are a couple heroes, I guess, in this story. I think Bernie is one of them. I think AOC is one of them. I think Mitt Romney for even putting the proposal in the first place. Tom Cotton, Josh Hawley, and others for beating back the regressive parts. Marco Rubio and I think it was Ben Cardin, those two senators who got the $350 billion. There are some people who fought real hard for real working Americans in this. But you see how many names did I just five.
Yeah.
There's 95 others, or 535 others. And guess which side they all fought on? That's what we're up against.
Where's progressive champion Elizabeth Warren, yes, who, by the way, floated some good ideas about what to do in terms of the corporate oversight and bailout provisions? I didn't hear anything from her yesterday.
She didn't do anything.
She didn't get any of the things that she was pushing for.
And she still voted for the bill. I mean, a lot. And this is what I truly despair on, which is, as I said, and I know all the people I just listed, they agree with what I'm saying about China and supply chains and about worker protections, about so much of how the economy should be changed. And yet, whenever it came time, it just showed they didn't have the ability, they didn't have the power to fight for it.
Yeah.
And that's the real, this revealed who has power in Washington. And when it's a 96-0 vote, they can force even people who don't even agree, even Bernie Sanders, the guy's a revolutionary, even the young right upstarts who came in questioning GOP orthodoxy on the tails of Trump, all of them had to vote for it because leadership put guns to their head and they said, if you don't vote for this bill, you will stop payments to American workers. And most people just can't live with that.
Yeah, and this, you know, you also have to look at Mitch McConnell. Who's the architect who decided to put all these pieces together? You can almost guarantee it was Mitch. It was the savviest move that you could possibly make, because if you had these pass in separate pieces where the corporate piece was separate, I'm not even sure it would have passed at all.
Yeah, I doubt
it certainly would have had much more stringent requirements on them. It would have been a much smaller dollar amount. We may have gotten some of those provisions that could at least tilt the playing field just the tiniest bit, which can make all the difference in the long term.
Yes, it can.
Instead, we are jacking the rig system up, you know, juicing it to levels we've never seen before. Yeah.
In terms of benefits, it's like here for the worker, here for the corporation, and instead it should be this way. Right?
Of course, but says everything, as we've been saying, priorities in this town never fail to disappoint. Coming up on Rising, Joe Biden and Me Too, startling claims from a woman who alleges pretty upsetting claims against the president. Hopeful. We're going to speak with Tara Reid. That is next.